In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and void, and wait a minute. When was the beginning? And how did God create the heavens and the earth and all the life it contains? Those questions probably weren't on the mind of the author of Genesis, but they preoccupy our modern approach to the first pages of the Bible. If you walk into a Christian church anywhere in the world and ask the people milling about what they believe about the origins of life and the universe, those that have an opinion would likely give you one of three different answers. Some argue that God created the universe and the earth and all its life, including humans, via miraculous divine action roughly 6 to 10,000 years ago. This position is called young earth creationism. Others might agree with the estimates from science that the universe and the earth are much, much older, roughly 13.8 billion years for the universe and 4.5 billion years for the earth, but that God still created life via a miraculous special creation on multiple occasions in a progressive fashion. This view is called old earth creationism or progressive creationism. Still others would also agree with the old age for the universe and earth, but believe that God created through the process of evolution. This view is called evolutionary creationism or theistic evolution. These very different answers beg one obvious question. Why don't we agree? It isn't because some have access to unique passages of scripture or different evidence from science. Rather, it's because we have fundamental disagreements about the very nature of science, about the Bible and how God acts in this world that influence our interpretations of the science and the relevant passages of scripture. Now, we will eventually get to discussing those Bible passages and the scientific evidence. They are very important. But first, we need to understand the assumptions that guide our understandings. Well, let's start with science. Science is a process that we use to study the world. Astronomers, the universe. Our goals are to describe what it's made of and how it works. New discoveries sometimes lead to new and better explanations, so scientific methods and conclusions are prone to change. Some see the dynamic nature of science as a fault and a reason not to trust its conclusions. Young Earth creationists especially believe that their interpretations of the Bible should trump the dynamic beliefs in science. It makes sense, at first glance, to trust God's unchanging Bible over an ever-changing human understanding of the world. But this assumption does not see that while the biblical canon is fixed, the interpretations and theological understandings that we pull from it are not. There are ancient and ongoing debates about how to interpret the Bible on the role of women in the church and family, on race and slavery, on faith versus works, on diet, on free will, sexuality, circumcision, and the list goes on, not to mention the passages on creation. So science and theology have more in common than most people think. Theology is the study of religious beliefs, and biblical theology comes from a dynamic examination of ancient scriptures which do not change. And scientific beliefs are assembled from a maturing examination of God's creation, whose laws and mechanisms appear to be just as fixed as the biblical canon. So leaving behind the rhetoric that the Bible overrules science, or that science corrects the Bible, we prefer to integrate science and theology into a unified search for understanding. And how would that integration of science and biblical theology play out? There is disagreement on this as well, and much of it circles around the topic of literary genre. No one thinks that everything in the Bible should be taken literally. Bibles don't spontaneously emit light, even though a literal interpretation of Psalm 119 suggests that they should. This is a metaphor in a poetic passage, and the Bible contains poetry and prose and narrative and different literary genres, some of which might feel foreign to modern readers. The better question then is which passages of Scripture should be taken literally and which should not, which leads us to the first chapters of Genesis. If, like young earth creationists, you hold that these chapters are a straightforward historical narrative providing a simple retelling of the exact process God used to create, then you might argue that a thorough understanding and strict interpretation of these passages should supplement, or maybe even dictate, our interpretations of the scientific evidence in the rocks and genes and universe. However, if these passages are not a simple historical narrative, and if they aren't written to teach us the mechanistic details of how it all went down, then we can allow science to answer our questions about timing and mechanism of creation. As we mentioned, a big part of this is also tied up in our views of how God acts and what it means that the Bible is inspired, and we'll address those topics in a future video. One other assumption that impacts our interpretations is the belief that studying God's creation and studying the Bible could lead us to different conclusions. And while there is historical baggage tied up in that concern, we agree with St. Augustine of Hippo that all truth is God's truth. And if science reveals something to be true, then we should also see it as a truth from God. It seems like we have outsourced most of our understanding of creation to science. Does Christian faith play a role in our study of nature? Is there a Christian version of science? Is there a disciple science? Our examination of the world produces many more questions than those that science is equipped to answer. Why is it all here? And are we responsible for its well-being? And is there meaning that we should derive from the story of the life and the universe that God created? Those questions matter, and science is not the right tool to answer them. Religion is all about meaning, and Christians would do well to harness our curiosity about the physical world and our questions about ultimate meaning and transcendence, and let them lead us to a reverent worship of and desire to follow our Creator. Thanks for watching. We've been encouraged over the past few years by some of the progress we've made in this conversation. There have been some great books published that include gracious dialogue and conversations between evolutionary creationists and young earth creationists, and between old earth creationists and young earth creationists. And we believe it's through those conversations, through that dialogue, that we will come to a clear sense of when and how God created, and also to greater unity in the Christian church around those beliefs. At Disciple Science, we want to fundamentally reshape the relationship between science and Christianity from one of tension to one of harmony. And we want to help you connect with God through God's creation. If you want to help us make more of these videos, you can support us by giving at our website at disciplescience.com, or you can support us by giving at patreon.com/disciplescience. Thanks again for watching. We will talk again soon.